Good evening everybody, and welcome to my latest model train review video. Tonight I'm going to review the Hornby National Railway Museum, also known as the NRM collection, special edition of the LNER Flying Scotsman Class A3 Steam Express locomotive. This was released in 2004 and it is commissioned by the National Railway Museum in York, complete with the NRM hologram on the side of the box. The reference number is 2441 and the wheel layout is 462, complete with the running number of 4472. This model is a premium model from the Hornby premium range, just to let you all know, and it's far superior to that of the old train set models that have been around since the 1960s. The model is DCC ready and it does have an 8-pin DCC socket on board, which is in the locomotive. The locomotive is also loco-driven as opposed to the standard tender drive, and there's some extra bits and bobs inside the box, including a National Railway Museum York plate, which is in this sachet here, which can be attached to the front of your Flying Scotsman model using a piece of blue tack. We've also got the operating instructions, which tells you how to care for your locomotive and how to lubricate the moving parts, etc. And also upon opening it up, it even tells you how to fix and replace the motor as necessary. And also in this diagram, I am pleased to say that the coal can be swapped for some real life coal if need be, and also how to take the body off the chassis upon fitting a DCC decoder. And also on the back of the instructions it tells you how to fit the extra detailing parts, which I will cover in a moment. Okay, let's have a look at the what I would call a work of art, which is the Flying Scotsman, after just going over these extra accessories that you get with it first. Just like with the Class 43 excuse me, HST, you do get a decoder insulating sleeve, although as I said before, most decoders that are made nowadays are sealed within like a layer of film, and therefore these sleeves are basically obsolete. So we'll just pop that down to one side with the instructions and the frontal nameplate that I showed you previously. And here's another detailing set. This is the brake rods, which actually go onto the underside of the Flying Scotsman model, which I'll show you in a moment. Right, now we've got the extra detailing parts in that covered, let's remove the Flying Scotsman from its box. Just like with the Hornby Class 60, you've got two plastic bands which simply slide off the ends as the polystyrene tray is split into two parts, which enables the user to remove the locomotive from the polystyrene more easily, and also it avoids damaging any fragile parts. And believe me, these premium models from Hornby do have a lot of fragile parts, so just to let you know that you have to handle these models with care as to avoid damaging them. On the top of the styrene tray we do have another set of accessories in a packet, and in this sachet here you've got a fine scale pony truck wheel with flanges, as where the default wheel, which is fitted onto the underneath down here where my finger is, which I'll show you in closer view soon, is actually got, has not got flanges to aid cornering on the R607 and the R609 curves. Because this is a fine scale model, it's not really recommended that you should use anything tighter than an R607 second radius curve because of the risk of derailments, etc. But it's entirely up to you, as you are the purchaser, if you decide to get one of these, on which tracks you wish to run it on. Also, besides this fine scale flange wheel, you get some extra detailing parts inside the packet, along with a mini set of instructions which tells you how to fit the fine scale wheel on the pony truck, which is underneath the driver's cab. So we'll just pop those to one side. Let's have a closer look at the Flying Scotsman. As I've said, just move the tissue back and handle this fine scale model with extreme care as to not damage any fragile parts. Very nice, very weighty. Likewise, I do like how Hornby have dedicated a very good amount of effort and attention to detail, as the rims of the wheels are actually painted white and you've got the metal like tyres as well. The premium Flying Scotsman model is actually loco-driven and the motor's actually mounted there. So all of this is like now driven from the locomotive, as opposed to the tender driven steam engines that were released in the 1980s and 1990s and before then, before most Hornby models were upgraded to use loco drive, which personally I prefer those to the tender drives, as they tend to have more pulling power. All the drawbars and the rods are separately etched, and also they've got fine details on them as well. Not sure if the camera can just pick that up, but also on the sides you've got the Flying Scotsman nameplate plus a special NRM plate on there, as this particular version of the Flying Scotsman is based on the Flying Scotsman as it was running in 2004 and before. I visited the National Railway Museum in 2006, and the real life Flying Scotsman was currently stripped down into parts and it's actually being restored. I'm not sure how the progression has gone since then, but hopefully I would love to see this icon of a steam engine return to the tracks soon, as I would rather like to film the real beast running around on rail tours someday. Excuse me. You've also got another gold plate, which actually is just a decal, it's not actually metal of anything, on the smoke deflector boxes. And also you've got a catenary warning sign there and there. You've also got some extra detailing parts down here, which are these gold or brass looking bits. Please pardon my ignorance on as to what they are, as I do not know steam engines too well. But likewise, I really do like this model. You've even got the fine scale lamp holders, which are moulded onto the front of the steam engine, and you've also got sprung buffers, just like you get with the diesel engines. Also, I do like the red lining, the camera can just pick that up, on the which has been carefully painted onto the chassis and the front guides as well, these front light bars that go from here down to there, if the camera can just focus on those. And also you've got the white lining around the front buffer beam, complete with, as it says, number 4472. You've also got a dummy screw link chain coupling, again, which I think is a nice bit of effort from Hornby. And I actually paid for this £95, as I bought it brand new from an online model shop, which I think is fantastic value. And I am actually considering whether to fit a smoke generator inside the front part of the Flying Scotsman. Okay, now showing you the front and the side, let's have a look in the cab. Oh, let's have a look at the cab first. You've got glazing, and the window is actually in the open position on this side, and it's mimicked on the other side as well. We just go around into the cab. I'll try and keep the light on it so you can all see inside. You've also got the driver's seat, and you've got the gauges, the pipes, and the levers and the valves, all faithfully modelled and based on the real thing. So again, well done Hornby. Even the firebox is replicated on this 176 scale 00 gauge model, just like the real thing. So as far as it goes, I have nothing but praise to give Hornby on this fantastic work of art, and especially as it's my favourite steam engine, the Flying Scotsman. Now, if we just turn the model upside down and carefully handle it, excuse me, you've got the pony truck, please do beg your pardon, sorry about that. You've also got these flangeless wheels on the pony truck. And the reason why these particular wheels do not have flanges is basically so it can corner okay without derailing on tighter curves, which actually do apply to the R607s and the R609s. But if you are fortunate enough to have a large model railway with very shallow curves, you can actually swap this flangeless wheel for the fine scale pony truck wheel, which is in this packet here. And Hornby have actually given you instructions which are in the packet, which tells you how to fit and change the wheel over with step-by-step instructions, which I think is good. Well, I think I've covered everything on the locomotive of the Flying Scotsman. Let's just move the tray backwards and pop the beast of the locomotive down there. Well, next thing we need to do is to cover the fender. And yes, excuse me, the tender also has removable coal, which you can remove using a small narrow nose screwdriver if you wish to replace it with real life coal. Sorry about that, didn't quite have the model in the camera shot, so I'll just show you the top again. You've also got the water pipe intake hatch on the back, complete with a recess so that the train crew can climb on the top and top the water tank up as necessary. On the back of the tender, you've also got these two levers here and here. You've got the coal recess of where the fireman would stick his shovel in there and basically take the coal of his shovel from the tender and shovel it into the firebox, which I do like, as it's been actually properly modelled on this premium model from Hornby. And you've also got a door on the left there, which I think leads down the side of the tender round to the back where this corridor is here, which enables crew changes to take place while the train is moving without having to stop. I think the Hornby Mollard which is the premium version I'm referring to, I think that also has one as well. Or one of the A4s does anyway. I don't yet have the Mullard, but I am planning to get it at some point, and I will do a review of that as well. As with the front of the Flying Scotsman, the locomotive counterpart, you've got sprung buffers, which are very nice. And you've also got an NEM coupler mounted on the back here as well. I prefer these nice looking narrow couplers as opposed to those horrible crude looking large ones from the 1980s, and they make the model look very nice and tidy. But if we just tilt the model up there, if you just see just above the coupler, and if I can keep the hook out of the way, you've actually got a chain coupler and a buckeye coupler just underneath the corridor mounted onto the buffer beam. And you've also got climb steps on both sides of the corridor there and there, complete with the catenary warning signs. And I think this could be a spy hatch or something to aid the crew when reversing or something like that. Now on the side of the tender, you've got the nicely printed LNER decals on the side, complete with the black and white lining that goes all the way around the LNER green livery. You've also got the red or maroon lining which runs along the chassis of the tender, and it goes round the axle boxes quite nicely. Well, that concludes my overall review of the Flying Scotsman model, and DCC users would be pleased to know that this model is fully DCC ready and it has the 8-pin DCC socket. My overall score rating, I think this has easily won a perfect 10 out of 10 from me, as I do love the Flying Scotsman. It is one of my favourite steam engines, and Hornby yet again has done a very good grand job on replicating this model in 00 gauge. So that concludes my review of the Hornby National Railway Museum Special Edition 2004 version of the Flying Scotsman model. If you have any comments or questions, please feel free to post them in the comment section below. And thank you for watching.